Welcome to Jerusalem, welcome to the Tower of David, the ancient citadel that has protected Jerusalem for over 2,000 years. Together, we're going to climb up to the most beautiful viewpoint of Jerusalem and discover the secrets of the city together. Follow me. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Jerusalem, welcome to the Tower of David. We are standing on top of the Fasael Tower, a tower that was built here 2,000 years ago by King Herod, overlooking the old city of Jerusalem. This is the best place to start uncovering the secrets of Jerusalem and finding out what made it the holy city for Judaism, Christianity, and Islam. We're going to start at the very beginning. We're going back to Bereshit. 5,780 years ago, according to the Jewish calendar, creation is starting. And where is it starting? You guessed right, from here, from Jerusalem. Behind me is the Dome of the Rock. It is called the Dome of the Rock because of a rock that is still inside. That rock is called the rock or the stone of foundation. When God starts out on a major project like creating the universe, even he needs a first milestone. In the case of Jerusalem, we're talking about an actual piece of limestone. Back then, if you would look from here, you would see nothing. Okay, there were no churches, no mosques, no synagogues, only a mountain. Just imagine my hand is the mountain of Moriah, mentioned in the Bible. And from the top of that mountain, there is a stone that sticks above. That is called the foundation stone from which the world was established. That's tradition number one that ties the Jewish people with Jerusalem. Another tradition, a little more late than the first one, is a father and son who are making their way to Jerusalem. It's a three-day journey from Be'er Sheva to the land of Moriah, and at the end of that journey they find themselves on top of the mountain right next to that same stone, the foundation stone. Abraham is requested to sacrifice Isaac, his beloved son, in order to prove the power of his faith. He takes Isaac, he ties him, not to just any stone that's up there, but to the foundation stone itself. He ties him up, he raises up the knife, and then in the last minute, what happens? Right, the angel interferes and says, "Do not touch the child." Isaac is saved. Instead, a ram is sacrificed. That's why, by the way, the Jews are blowing the horns, the shofar, on the high holidays, on Rosh Hashanah and Yom Kippur. It comes from that very, very formative moment here in Jerusalem. So these two Jewish traditions tie the Jewish people with Jerusalem ever since, meaning that King David is going to come to this area and he's going to decide that his capital is going to be right below the Temple Mount at the City of David. His son Solomon is going to build the first temple exactly where the Golden Dome stands today. That temple will be destroyed, then another one will be built. The second temple will be built by King Herod, the same king who built the tower that we're now on, and will be the most extravagant, beautiful building of the Middle East. In the year 70, the destruction is happening. There is no more Jerusalem, no more temple. And ever since, Jewish people around the world will say, "L'shana haba'a b'Yerushalayim," next year in Jerusalem. This is the Jewish connection. If we already mentioned the temple, let's switch and talk about the Christian connection and talk about the pilgrimages to the temple with one of the most famous pilgrims who came to Jerusalem, Jesus of Nazareth. Jesus of Nazareth comes from the north through the Judean desert up the Mountain of Olives in order to celebrate Passover with his students here in Jerusalem. The Last Supper, Passover Seder. Stands on the Mountain of Olives, look down to the second temple, which is there back in those times, 2,000 years ago, and gives a prophecy of destruction. No stone will be left unturned, he says, and this opens the last week of his life here in Jerusalem. The week ends where the two domes of the Church of the Holy Sepulchre stand today. That's the place of Jesus's crucifixion, burial, and according to the Christian tradition, resurrection. So the Christian beginning is also very much connected with Jerusalem, and that's how it becomes the most holy place in the world in Christianity. Today we're looking at the Temple Mount and we're looking at two Muslim structures, the Dome of the Rock, the Golden Dome, and the Al-Aqsa Mosque. These have been around for about 1300 years. How does Islam connect with Jerusalem? We're going back in time, it's the 7th century, and the Quran is telling us the story of Muhammad making his way من المسجد الحرام إلى المسجد الأقصى, from the holy mosque, the black rock, the Kaaba in Mecca, to the farthest mosque. Where is the farthest mosque? The tradition will tell us that it's here in Jerusalem, and not only in Jerusalem, on the Temple Mount. This journey is made on a magical winged horse named Al-Burak. At the end of that flight, he finds himself by the stones of the Western Wall, climbing up to the destroyed platform of the temple, and he finds a very specific stone. Yes, the foundation stone in Jewish tradition becomes a whole new story in the Muslim tradition, when from that stone Muhammad rises seven heavens above. On the seventh heaven he meets Allah, which gives him the commandment of prayer, which means that every Muslim around the world that prays five times a day, that's the number of prayer that was given back then, is connecting with Jerusalem immediately. And that's how Jerusalem becomes the third most holy place in Islam. After Mecca and Al-Madinah comes Jerusalem. So all the beginnings are here. But what I'm going to show you next is that all the endings are also here in Jerusalem, and the restart. Behind me you see the Mountain of Olives. This is the restart button of the world. I want you to look at a few things that will help us tell the story. The first thing that we're going to look at is the cemetery that is all across the foothill of the Mountain of Olives. Jews have been asking to be buried there for thousands of years. Why? Because according to the Jewish prophecy, when the Messiah comes, the Mountain of Olives is going to be split into two parts, kind of like the parting of the Red Sea, and the righteous ones will be able to rise from their graves and make the way to rejoin the Stone of Foundation, to bring on sort of a second creation, and a new, better reality will come upon the earth. That's the Jewish story of the end of time. Let's switch to the Christian story. Up the mountain, you see there's a beautiful church up there. Kind of looks like a big pencil. That is the Church of Ascension. Who ascended? Jesus. After the resurrection, he walks around for 40 days, then finds himself back on top of the Mountain of Olives, goes back to the heavens. And according to the tradition, this is the place that at the end of time, he will someday return. Here in Jerusalem, and a new, better reality will come upon the earth when the kingdom of heaven is here on earth. And last but not least, if you look above from the cemetery, you see that there's a building there, pink colored with seven arches. That is the Seven Arch Hotel. The architects got the idea to design it in this way from a Muslim tradition that says that at the end of time, on the Day of Judgment, what's going to happen is that there's going to be a bridge that's going to be as thin as a hair from the Mountain of Olives to the Temple Mount. It will be carried over seven arches, and the righteous ones will be able to cross to Muhammad's place of ascension at the Temple Mount and receive immortal life, and the evil sinners will fall to their fiery death on the other side at the Kidron Valley. So we had three beginnings and three endings and restartings of reality. And it's all here in Jerusalem. When people look to their past, they look to Jerusalem. When people look to their future and want to give themselves some sort of an answer for what's going to happen with the unknown and the end of time, they look to Jerusalem as well. Therefore, you can see that Jerusalem is more than just a place. It's a state of mind. Thank you so much for watching. You're welcome to also check out our website, our YouTube channel, the social media for more content and more videos. See you next time. Goodbye.